In this Q&A video, we're going to answer the question, how much light can I spill onto a neighbouring property? This video relates to the garden lighting ideas video that we made in association with LEDvance, where we looked at some innovative products and ways that they could be used to illuminate outdoor spaces for both practical and also for decorative uses. So if you haven't already seen that video, then please check it out after watching this one, along with the one that we did on the LEDvance floodlight family. But let's focus on this topic. Information on this subject has been published by the Institution of Lighting Professionals in their document, The Reduction of Obtrusive Light, which is freely available as a PDF on their website. Ultimately, the answer is that it depends on the area that you're in. The document defines five different environmental zones in Table 2, from E0 to E4, with E0 being the most sensitive to light pollution, in areas where astronomical observations are carried out or areas defined by UNESCO as starlight reserves, and E4 being urban areas like towns and cities where lots of nighttime activity takes place. So you can see that there's going to be vastly different requirements between somewhere that has a protected status due to sensitivity to light and a city centre that is probably already well illuminated for safety and the reduction of crime. And this is borne out for us in Table 3, where we find some values for the maximum amount of light that are allowed to hit a neighbouring property, with particular focus on the windows of that property. The table refers to illumination in the vertical plane. What does that mean? Well, we can demonstrate by using a piece of lighting calculation software like Dialux or Relux. So let's say we've got a property here and I want to add some outside lights to it. And over here there's another property and I'm going to check the value of light to make sure that it doesn't exceed the value stated in the ILP guidance note. So I can create a measuring surface that will check the value of light hitting it and give us some key values for the light levels on here. And by setting that up so it stands vertically on the wall over here, I can confirm these values. Now I could, if I had concerns about the light level hitting the windows on the building, also make some smaller ones to get the values on those exact areas. So if I install this floodlight from the LEDvance floodlight family that we also made a video on, and just tweak the height of that and the angle that it's pointing at, we can then run the calculation and get the values off the software. So you can see there that the light levels on this surface are
1.54 lux
at the most and
1.19 lux
as an average. Now if I compare that to Table 3 in the ILP guidance note, I can see what environmental zones it would be acceptable in. Just a quick explanatory note on why there's two figures quoted for each environmental zone. You'll see there that there's a pre-curfew and a post-curfew value. Now that's not referring to a time when we all should be off the streets and in bed in order to quell civil unrest. It's merely an allotted time decided on by the local planning authority to determine when artificial light levels should be reduced. So you can see that for an area designated as zone E0, there is simply no illumination from artificial sources allowed, which is fair enough as it could throw off astronomical observations or ruin the view of those UNESCO starlight reserves. If this property was in a zone designated E1 or a natural area, perhaps a relatively uninhabited rural area, a national park or an area of outstanding natural beauty, then there's a maximum value of 2 lux allowed, dropping to less than 0.1 lux post curfew. Although that little asterisk there suggests that if we're talking about road lighting, the value could go up to 1 lux. For a zone designated E2, which could be sparsely inhabited rural areas, villages, or relatively dark outer suburban locations, then we've got a value of 5 lux pre-curfew and 1 lux post-curfew. For zone E3, which is well-inhabited rural and urban settlements, small town centres of suburban locations, there's a maximum of 10 lux pre-curfew and 2 lux post-curfew. And for an E4 zone, which is town, city centres with high levels of nighttime activity, we've got a value of 25 lux before the curfew and 5 lux after the curfew. So the maximum value on our calculation surface was
1.54 lux.
Which means we're well within the limits for zones
E1 to E4,
but couldn't apply this solution in zone E0, obviously. So there we go. That's the guidance for maximum illumination levels onto neighbouring properties. And it's pretty straightforward. Obviously, if you're not sure which of the environmental zones the area that you're working in falls within, then simply contact the local planning authority and they'll be able to tell you if any of them apply. Now, there are a couple of other considerations that need to be made in terms of outside lighting and the intrusion of that light onto other properties, but we'll cover some of those in future videos. Of course, as always, we want to hear from you. Do you factor intrusive light into your outside lighting installations? Is it something that perhaps you'll think about more in the future? Please leave your thoughts and questions in the comments section below, And as always, thank you very much for watching.